Hello friends, I am Deepak Balodi and welcome to the lecture 5 of the topic module Semiconductor Theory. We are into the topic extrinsic semiconductors and we have already seen the carrier concentration into the extrinsic semiconductor. And we appreciated also the result that was the carrier concentration, the final carrier concentration of extrinsic semiconductor rises by at least 10 to the power 4 or 10 to the power 5 order for a moderate doping case. Even for low doping case, it definitely increases by 10 to the power 2 or 10 to the power 3. So that's a significant increment, and with this we also saw in a numerical that how a lot of better conductivity is achieved when we go for that higher concentration. So now there is a time to appreciate it much by calculating the current densities and conduction phenomena. So this topic would be dynamics of semiconductor. Basically it is all devoted to the conduction. Okay, so it will be analogous to the conduction or dynamics phenomena what we saw in intrinsic semiconductor case. So there we defined that two basic phenomena for carrier conduction or charge conduction, especially for semiconductors. So those two phenomena are drift phenomena and diffusion. We have already introduced drift phenomena in the intrinsic semiconductor, and in the same analogous way we'll see this drift here also. But before that, let us quantify the diffusion phenomena. Diffusion phenomena, as by its name we all are well familiar with, that diffusion happens in any substance or in any material whenever there is a difference in concentration of particle. So if at some local region of that material or that substance, if there are lots of particles, the concentration is very high. On some side or on some corner, if the concentration is poor or bad, then there is a diffusion of those carriers or those elements from that denser side to rarer side. So that's what exactly is the diffusion phenomena. And interestingly, for this phenomena to happen, no external agent or no external force is required. If the concentration gradient is developed, for that development we require an external effort or some non-thermal equilibrium phenomena. But if it happens, then the movement of carriers from denser side to rarer side happens automatically without any guidance of any external force or any external electric field. So therefore, let me quantify it as diffusion phenomena says that carrier, either electron or holes, move from high concentration area or high concentration region to lower concentration region. And when they do so, then all because holes or electrons are the free carriers, and they are as well as they are charged particles, so when they move, then they create or they constitute the current or current density. So therefore the current density, which is here called diffusion current density, indicated by J diff here, it could be all due to holes movement or electrons movement, any one of that, but in general is directly proportional to the charge concentration gradient. So please mind it, this is charge concentration gradient, means charge decreasing with the as a rate with respect to the distance, or increment of charge per unit distance. So therefore this is dq by dx, or the total charge will always be charge on one particle, either electron or hole, that is q, small q, 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb, into the carrier concentration. So, n into q. So, I am not writing only for electron, this could be equally well said for holes as well. So, there we can write dpq by dx. So, I am not quantifying it exactly, but this is how the concept is built. Now, to understand this, we can also produce a figure. Assuming a piece of, let's say, n-type semiconductor. Now, assume that this side there are lots of electrons. So, the left end of this piece has lots of electrons. And let's say at this distance, x1 to x2, there is a delta x distance in between this, and at this place, at the neighborhood of this distance, this point, the concentration is, let's say, n1, and at this place, let's say the concentration is n2, and definitely n1 is greater than n2, so delta n will be n1 minus n2. So delta x is x2 minus x1, all because in the positive direction we are measuring, positive x, but delta n is n1 minus n2. So what happens? All because of this, the electrons would have a natural tendency to move from denser side to rarer side. That's what is the diffusion phenomena. So the electrons move from this to this. So this is the movement of electron. And they will try to equalize the concentration everywhere same within the semiconductor. So they will keep on diffusing until and unless they satisfy a condition of equilibrium when there is a uniform concentration throughout. So let me mark diffusion continues till a uniform concentration throughout is achieved. So it continues. So, we are not going to wait up to that time, but all because the electrons will diffuse to that side. Please mind the term diffuse, they are not drifted. For drift, it requires an external force, that was electric field in this concept. But here in diffusion, all due to themselves, concentration gradient or charge concentration gradient, they are trying to diffuse. So, all because of that, the current will take place into this direction. So, this will be J. diff, all due to electron. So therefore, in this example, if I demarcate two cases, diffusion current due to electron and diffusion current due to holes. So we have developed this picture. So this picture corresponds to this case. So in n-type semiconductor, holes are only minority carriers, so I'm not showing that. But this phenomena may also happen with the minority carriers. And in fact, in practical scenarios, the diffusion of minority carrier is only significant. So that's how happens, that I'll let you know later on. But all because this scenario has been given to us. So, as we have formulated this, or we can use this, so J diffusion N will be equal to, or that will correspond to, let me start from the scratch, this will be dNq upon dx. So, at this place, the charge concentration is total charge concentration is Q into N1, because N1 is the carrier concentration, electrons per unit volume, and each electron consists of this charge, so this is this. Similarly, the charge concentration here at x2 distance would be N into Q2. So the gradient charge concentration gradient will be Qn2 minus Qn1, all because of in this direction. So that will be NQ2 minus Qn1. So I'm not looking at the sign for now, all because this is the positive direction, so we are taking this direction as a reference. So it is NQ2 minus N2Q, not NQ2, N2Q minus QN1. So if that happens, then this is QN2 minus QN1 upon delta X. Delta X can also be, you can first write X2 minus X1. But see, in this problem, because we are directly relating it with the current, and current is always in the opposite direction of the electron flow, so there must be a negative sign attached here. And all because of that, this comes as N2 minus N1, Q could be taken out, so minus minus becomes plus, so Q, N1 minus N2, minus I have taken out, and N1 minus N2 is delta N by delta X, and when delta X tends to 0, so this is nothing but Q dN by dx. So from here only we get this. So therefore, this will finally give me, J diffusion N is minus, what did I write, dN by dx, and sorry, directly proportional, and there comes a proportionality constant as dN minus was getting plus in that expression, all because we start from minus, because current density or current is in opposite direction of electron flow. For that we take it minus, but all because dN is also negative in this direction, because electrons are moving from denser to rarer side, so dN is also negative, so negative negative becomes positive. So at the end, the diffusion current density or diffusion current or due to electrons has a positive polarity here. So dN Q dN by dx, where dN is called diffusivity constant. Diffusivity constant for electron, or diffusion constant for electron, or electrons diffusion constant. You can take by any name. So the diffusion current density is Q dN dN by dx. So dN by dx is carrier concentration. So ultimately we can see the carrier concentration gradient results into a current. That means if there is a uniform doping concentration or uniform carrier concentration, maybe because of doping or maybe because of intrinsic nature, if there is a uniform carrier concentration everywhere at any corner of the material, then diffusion cannot take place. For diffusion to take place, there has to have a scenario where there is concentration gradient, carrier concentration gradient. There's a difference in concentration, and if it happens, then diffusion continues till a uniform density is maintained. Okay, with the same token we can proceed, and in the same picture, if you take it as a p-type material, then what difference will come? If lots of holes are positive charges as holes are here, and there are less number of holes in this corner, so holes will diffuse from this left to right, and as they will diffuse, the all those things I will be writing here. The only difference will be in this place, the J diffusion current density, all due to holes, P suffix, will be from here only, D PQ. P is the concentration of holes per unit volume dx. There will not be any negative sign, because if holes are moving in this direction, then holes current will also be in the same direction, because the holes movement is defining the direction of current. So here we started with minus sign, all because this current was related with the electron. And minus and reduction, because the electrons are moving from denser to rarer side, both things make it finally positive. But here, all because we start with positive sign, all because holes direction is the current direction, but dp is going to be negative because more holes are moving to the area where there are less number of holes. So the concentration basically will be decreasing. So with the same, we will be ending up with the negative sign here. Negative sign also. Okay. So these two are just this is for the sake of formula. Otherwise, whenever we'll be keeping units, we always intuitively check it analytically that it is in the same direction. So ultimately, both the contributions will get added. So if there are electrons and holes both, and if both are diffusing, although that effect is not very practical, but assume a case, a cumulative case, when both, composite case, when electrons and holes both are there, and both have concentration gradient, then both will be moving in opposite direction and they'll be creating a current which will be in support to each other. So ultimately both will come into the same direction, and this scenario when both electrons and holes are finding concentration gradient is rarer, very very rare case. So generally it happens only because of electron, or it happens only because of holes. Diffusion current simultaneously due to both diffusion effects is very uncommon. So okay. So with this we can write the final current as a total current. So this we can remember this. And yeah, one very important concept that why did not we discuss this effect diffusion in the intrinsic case. Although this diffusion effect may take place anywhere if this scenario is given. Now the only question is how and when this scenario will come. That means how and when the concentration gradient will happen. See, all these understandings have been developed assuming that this scenario has been provided to us, means somebody or with some mechanisms we have developed this scenario. This scenario means at some corner there are lots of holes, lots of electrons, at some other corner there are very few number of electrons, and in between there are variations in the concentrations. So how the scenario will happen? Because an intrinsic semiconductor, every time we saw that at each and every corner of the semiconductor piece, the intrinsic carrier concentration was same. And in fact, in thermal equilibrium, if we have maintained any piece of semiconductor for a long, long time, then there has to have a uniform concentration of either electron or holes. So therefore, in intrinsic semiconductor, it is very difficult to find to encounter a situation when we have carrier concentration gradient. We have carrier concentrations, but in intrinsic it is almost uniform everywhere. There is one more point why we do not consider intrinsic semiconductors eligible for diffusion effect, because intrinsic semiconductor at all are not of much use in practicals or in commercial applications. We are always going to make use of extrinsic semiconductors. We only started with intrinsic just to make the study as a reference, and ultimately we had to come to this extrinsic case. So we know that we are never going to make benefit of diffusion effect, and that too in intrinsic semiconductor. So therefore we did not give this diffusion a much concern into the intrinsic case. But in extrinsic also we need to understand why this will happen. So again, please mind it, we have started from a scene, from a scenario when this situation was given to us. How the situation will come into the picture, that is the question. So that is dedicated to a particular topic called as non-equilibrium charge injection or carrier injection. So it happens all due to the phenomena like, let me quantify it, the carrier concentration gradient occurs due to. So whenever in a piece of external or extrinsic semiconductor, because it is in thermal equilibrium, so everywhere at any corner the charge concentration or sorry the carrier concentration is uniform. So in order to deviate it from uniform to non-uniform, at some corner more number of carriers, at some corner less number of carriers, so in order to develop this scenario we need to inject carriers somewhere. So it happens, it looks like we have injected lots of electrons at this corner only, and here it was almost the neutral case or the unaffected case, which we generally call as bulk semiconductor. So if we from external effect, if we somehow dope or insert some majority or minority carriers, then this may happen, this scenario may happen. So how to inject carriers or how to locally create more number of carriers at this region of the semiconductor? So this we can do by imparting or focusing beam of light. So by focusing beam of light, light is nothing but photon. So photon energy is targeted here at this piece, at this corner of this piece. If we threw out, eliminate it with the photons, then throughout the carrier will rise. So everywhere there will be more number of carriers, but there will not be any gradient difference between carrier concentration. But if we locally eliminate this region, so this is local elimination. So focusing beam of light at a particular corner. So that another case could be when we heat it up suddenly and then we get it down. So this was at room temperature, suppose at 300 degree Kelvin, and we suddenly heat it up to 300 to some 450 or 500 degree Kelvin, or suppose anything, or only 50 degree more. So we heated it and suddenly we dropped that heat, or suddenly we take it away from that furnace. So what will happen? So for that moment when we heated it up, at each and every corner there will be more number of carriers than as compared to its equilibrium concentration at room temperature. So suddenly we elevated it up to some any other temperature, delta T, above room temperature. So the carrier concentration will change, but it will change everywhere. Then, all because we have cooled it down or we have taken it back to the room temperature, but all those carriers will not settle down immediately. So they will try to diffuse with each other. And then maybe we cannot plot this local scenario with respect to x, then we need to plot it with respect to time. So then also diffusion phenomena, because for momentarily time the carrier concentration was gone up from the room temperature constant, room temperature concentration. So therefore for some time it will take some time to get settled down, so the excess carriers will lose out their existence and they will come to the final equilibrium. So that also a sudden heat. So these are certain reasons, we will not entertain these reasons now. In a brief lecture we will see how to have these reasons and how to solve the equations, because ultimately they lead to the non-equilibrium cases. So the gist of this is how this happens is, in a one line I can say, providing a non-equilibrium scenario for some time. Providing a non-equilibrium scenario for some time. So if we do so, either we can do in this manner or we can do in this manner. So if we do so, then this will happen. And definitely in order to have this, it is very difficult to practically have all these things in intrinsic, because ultimately we are not going to make use of intrinsic. So therefore we did not study this effect into the intrinsic semiconductor. But it is not a hard and fast rule. Even if in an intrinsic semiconductor we do this, then diffusion will take place. Okay. So now here comes the point which we were interested in from very starting. Now we are trying to write the final current density in extrinsic, or whatever we will study will be equally applicable for intrinsic with some intuitive use of that semiconductor. So let me finalize it first. So in general, the J total is always J diffusion plus J drift, and we know that J diffusion, so in a piece of semiconductor there are electrons, there are holes. I'm not considering any special case of n-type or p-type. It could be anything. It could be composite, it could be intrinsic, it could be n-type, it could be p-type. For any general semiconductor, if there are n number of holes and p number of electron concentration, then the total current density, and also we have applied an electric field E, and also there may be a carrier concentration gradient, then the total current density will be diffusion, J diffusion all due to electrons plus J diffusion all due to holes. Now we will not keep any sign here, let that sign come into the formula. So we are not writing any sign here, and we'll check it out analytically. Plus J drift, so it is J drift, we have already seen the formula for electron. Okay, so this is the final form. Let's concentrate on n-type material, then we can concentrate on p-type material, but you need not to clarify everything here. You just remember this, and as per the problem statement we can classify the cases. We can always start from here, and it is suggested to always start from here or have that thing in our mind. Then anytime whatever is required we can write down in these cases, but if we understand these cases it will make our concepts more clear. And in intrinsic semiconductor also we can see. Okay, so in n-type we are assuming n is approximately nd. If we have done nd amount of doping concentration of donor impurities, p is approximately na. And intrinsic, n is equals to p is equals to ni. Okay, so then here if there is total diffusion current is total diffusion current is J diffusion due to N plus J diffusion due to P, that is J drift N plus J drift P. Okay, it may look surprising sometimes, because if already we have declared N type, then why we are considering both the cases, all due to N, all due to P? So you see, at any moment we can neglect the effect of minority carrier conductivity or minority carrier conduction, but it is always suggested, recommended, that you always start with the general form, and at any level whenever you require you can neglect the effect of or the contribution of minority carriers. So therefore I am carrying just for the sake of generality still. Then J and drift is, we'll derive the directions intuitively, not writing here. Although for the same electric field, both electrons and holes will be moving opposite, but their currents will be added up because electron current will be in opposite direction. So ultimately they will add up. And sigma NE and sigma PE we knew. This is NQ mu NE plus EQ mu PE. Now you can write total. Now you see, all because here the N is much larger than P. N is much larger than P. So this can be neglected, that we have already seen. And all because of that, this approximately is only NQ mu NE. Otherwise, there is no harm in writing total, but anytime you can do this. Because this will be at least 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 orders less than this. At least 4 or 5 orders less than this. So there is no sense of writing it and adding it every time. The same thing may be happen because n is greater than p, then there may happen that n could be greater than, or dn could be greater than dp. But this is not necessary. Even in the case of n greater than p, even in n type, the dp by dx, because it matters with dx and it matters with dp. Even if n is greater than p, but it may happen that the change in hole concentration is much more significant than change in electron concentration. So the suggestion is that please do not neglect this term always. Do not neglect at first place. Means at this place itself, please do not neglect. What I'm saying is it may be neglected because it might be very small number, but please do not neglect it at first place. Just try to check it out, the numeric figures, and then anytime we can neglect it. And then if these two are happened, then J total is J fusion plus J drift. So all because this term and this term, they two are the relevant term here. Similarly, the same procedure, so we need not to write, but just for the sense of completeness, I'll write it right here also. So the same thing will remain here, the same up to this will remain here, and here the J drift will be approximately, all because of the holes, because here holes are majority carriers, so this will be approximately PQ mu PE. And again, this will be mainly due to the diffusion current given by holes, but still the minority component might be important, might be significant even more than majority. So, and that is a practical scenario. In most of the cases, we'll see that even if it is n-type, but the diffusion current all due to holes will matter. Or if it is p-type, but then the diffusion currents all due to electrons will be more significant. So please, mind this point that please do not try to make any approximation at this place. So that completely will be writing here, and then J again will be J diffusion plus J drift. In intrinsic, we have seen intrinsic, although diffusion phenomena is very rare, it is impractical to obtain all these efforts and doing all these efforts into the intrinsic, because ultimately we know that we are starting with very poor number of concentrations, so therefore it is illogical to proceed. But for the sake of generality, we can, anytime we can have this, we'll start, and we'll not be losing any term. So in the intrinsic, both these terms, these two terms, will be equally comparable, almost equally comparable. Okay. So with this, last point is that there must be some effect in diffusion phenomena, there must be some relevance with the mobility. Because what mobility was? The readiness of a carrier to move. How much a carrier is ready to move. If it is in such a periodic energy functions, which is less governed, less concerned with that material, or with that particle, then it can be easily moved with the lower electric field that we saw in the drift phenomena. But in the same diffusion also, a particle or an element or a carrier has to move. Again, if there is a sense of movement, although due to the internal reasons of concentration gradient, but it has to move. And when it has to move, the readiness of its movement will be definitely be significant. So again, the mobility should take place, should take a significant place in the diffusion phenomena. So where will it come for that relation? And that says that dn, the diffusivity constant for electrons, or electrons diffusion constant, is equals to mu n vt, where vt is the thermal voltage. So as you can write, mu n kt by q, or dp is mu p vt, where it is mu p kt by q. So therefore, the diffusivity constants are directly proportional to mu n and mu p. So if the readiness, we have already seen mu n is greater than mu p, so dn will also be greater than dp. So all because there is a high readiness of electrons to move, so that readiness in movement will help in both drift and diffusion phenomena. But the interesting result is that the ratios are like this: dN by mu n dP by mu p is equals to Vt. Vt is nothing but kT by q. So generally people remember this, but with this we should remember that diffusivity constants are in proportionality, or they are in proportion to the mobilities. How are the mobilities? How are the diffusivity constants? And the units is centimeter square per second. Okay, so anytime we can fetch it out from here. So from here, if you see units, centimeter square per volt second into thermal voltage. Voltage gets cancelled. So centimeter square per second. So that is the diffusivity constant. Okay, so this Einstein relation helps a lot in relating the drift and diffusion phenomena, or in relating the mobility concept of drift from there to the concept of diffusion. So with this we end up with the major concept of dynamics, but still there are lots of concepts are still remaining, small concept. Let us see those. Okay, so having done all the four cases, 8.1 we started with the carrier concentration in intrinsic semiconductor. Then we went for the dynamics or the conduction phenomena, 8.2, into the intrinsic semiconductor. Then we went for B.1, case B, for extrinsic semiconductor carrier concentration. And then with the carrier concentration, we again evaluated the dynamics or conduction of the extrinsic semiconductor at B.2. So we have covered all the major section, and now some small points like one abnormal effect, which is mobility degradation and velocity saturation. So these two things are almost related. Mobility degradation, it tells us that mobility is no more a constant, or it's in no sense it is an absolute constant, I must say. For all the practical scenarios, for some general scenarios, it is almost a constant. But for some typical conditions, like for very very high doping, at some very elevated or very very low temperatures, it is a variable, or it is no more a perfect constant. So therefore, how does it vary? And so this makes lots of theoretical concepts, which are generally asked in lots of public sector exams or in GATE. Therefore, it is important to cover. So there are, for mobility degradation, there are two effects. So as the name itself tells, lattice scattering means, in the good crystal we have seen that all these lattice centers are nothing but the centers of atom that they have placed, and they are in a 3D fashion. They are very well arranged in the intrinsic semiconductor. The only difference comes in extrinsic semiconductor is that at some lattice centers there are impurity atoms. Otherwise, generally as a whole, there are the internal pure intrinsic atoms only, because the impurity is also a lot of order less than the intrinsic concentration. So in this, what happens that as temperature is increased, well beyond the room temperature, or beyond the absolute zero, in fact, let me make it very general, then what happens? Mobility comes down. So let me write it step by step. So then, first of all the lattice points, atoms, they are in well collaboration with each other, as they are making the covalent bonds like this, as well as their electrons are into the covalent bond, and they are a heavy masses, relatively heavier mass than the carriers. See, electron and holes are always the very very light particle, the lightest particle in fact, but in respect of that, the ions or the atoms are basically heavier. They are heavier in mass, they are heavier in size. So therefore, it is very difficult for them to move. They cannot move because they are in well collaboration with the covalent bond with their neighbor atoms. So as temperature increases, the thermal energy increases. So the thermal energy increases, and all due to that, there happens the lattice vibrations. Or because they cannot move, but at their own centers they start moving. So there happens lattice vibrations, which is given by phonon energy. So phonon energy, or we have seen this in the concept of indirect and direct band gap. So we saw that the phonon energy is nothing but the energy or the momentum transferred or given to the lattice atoms while they vibrate, because the actual atomic picture is highly governed by lots of periodic functions, energy functions. So therefore, when they move like this, or when they vibrate at their own lattice centers, they are not moving away, but at their own places they are vibrating. They produce hindrances to the carrier movement, like an electron is moving like this. So because this atom is vibrating, this atom is vibrating, this atom is vibrating, so they will produce hindrances for carriers to move. They will produce hindrances to carriers to move, to movement. And all because of that, the readiness of the particles or the carriers for movement will come down. So therefore the mobility comes down. And the relation is mobility is proportional to this. And this effect of mobility, or this function of mobility, is basically understood as mu L, let me call it mu L, L for lattice scattering, and the middle trend is something like this, roughly. So if this is mu L, this is temperature. So this is one effect. As temperature increases above, not only above room temperature, but at room temperature also, the finite value of mobility is governed all due to that. So at a high temperature, this effect is dominating, very much dominating. It takes mobility to a very, very low value. What happens in impurity scattering? Generally observed in extrinsic semiconductor. See, this effect of lattice scattering may happen anywhere, everywhere, be it intrinsic or be it extrinsic, because it is all about the atom's vibration at their own lattice points. So generally this is more profound, or an effect which is mainly observed in intrinsic, as well as it is also observed in extrinsic. But this is all about the impurity atoms scattering, or impurity atoms vibration, thermal agitation, due to thermal agitation. So let's assume there is some boron ion here, and then there is silicon, 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 silicon. Boron ion is a negative ion because it has donated one hole. So as temperature is decreased, as temperature is decreased, what happens? That the at lower temperature, let me say like this, or let me first clarify this. What is actually this? Any electron which is moving like this, was moving like this due to an electric field or due to any other reasons or diffusion, anyhow. So there is the effect of electric field or ionic interaction. So at the neighborhood of any ion, there is a field given by that ion, electric field, or there is a sense of field at the neighborhood of that ion. So whenever an electron or a hole passes away from that region, it experiences an influence by that ion. So all due to that, this will get deviated. So let's say this was the original direction. This should have been the original direction, but all because it is deviated from this, so it may go like this. So this is a scattered path.
This is expected path.
So you see, if any particle or any carrier, electron or hole, passes in the close proximity, within the close proximity of any ion, negative or positive, it will experience the electric field or the ionic interaction of that impurity. And all because of that, its original path will get deviated. It will move within or towards the ion if it is an attractive force, or it will move away from that ion if it is a repulsive force. All because of that, its motion will get deviated, and all this effect will come into its velocity, and therefore this has been modeled as the effect on mobility. So therefore the ionic interactions or this effect will be more into the, so as doping concentration increases, this is a weak function of doping concentration, but it is a function. So the mobility model for impurity scattering is that reduces. That is obvious, because if there are more number of impurities, then there will be a lot of ionic interaction in between the carrier movement and the ionic field or their scattering field. So therefore the mobility will be severely affected, and it has been seen that mu I is directly proportional to T to the temperature in this fashion. This is just in inversion with this, and these all are approximate effects. I'm not writing in actual. So approximately the temperature we write, then this is something like this. So this is an increasing function with respect to temperature. So this is mu I. So impurity model, mobility increases with temperature. So if there is less temperature, there is, it is less significant, the effect is less significant, and therefore it remains like this. And when temperature at higher temperature, the effect is less significant, so mobility remains at a higher value. But at lower temperature, still there is an ionic field, but all because carriers, electrons and holes are not having enough energy to penetrate deep into this, so they will get lots of deviation. So therefore the mobility will come down severely. Okay, if we combine both the effects, so total effect is given as this, 1 upon mu is equals to 1 upon mu I plus 1 upon mu L. So this is very interesting to see, means the effective mobility, let me call it effective, this is the final or effective mobility. In general, what we are considering at any temperature, we are considering it to be constant as a function of T to the power 3 by 2, and this is mu L as a function of T to the power minus 3 by 2. So these two we have combined, and therefore the final one comes as something like this. So at room temperature, somewhere we are somewhere here. Okay, so therefore we are using this mobility. But mobility is definitely a function of temperature, what we can see. So this is the final mu effective. An interesting point is that the effective mobility is lower than the lowest effect out of these two. At somewhere the middle, at near about the room temperature, it goes to a good value, a sufficiently good value, but then at either side it reduces. So therefore this is in general the effect of mobility. So please remember, the effective mobility is governed by both the effects, impurity scattering and the lattice scattering, and it is a function of both, and the resultant value is lower than the lowest value. So that's what how it is. And all due to that, there comes a deviation from the ideal drift law, drift velocity. That is, so this velocity saturation, this says, so far we have seen what we have seen as a drift velocity Vd. We know so far that this is the drift velocity, all because we know that drift velocity is mu e, that we saw in intrinsic case, and this is equally applicable here in the extrinsic case. So for the total drift velocity, you can anytime write mu n e plus mu p e. Okay, So let me consider any, either electron or hole, any one of that at one time.
Okay. Then we have seen that at lower electric field, the linear relation holds. The linear relation holds almost perfectly.
So, at the lower electric field, but as we move around 10 to the power 4 or 10 to the power 5 volts per centimeter, like somewhere here, 10 to the power 4 or 10 to the power 5 volts per centimeter value, and much beyond that, then what happens? All due to the high electric field. So this is applicable only at the lower electric field, and mu is constant at this, up to this, but all because we have seen that mobility varies in some uncertain or abnormal conditions. So all because of that, as electric field increases, due to that the energy of lattice as well as impurity centers increase, and therefore the mobility comes down. Because electric field increases, so the lattice points and impurity itself. Earlier we studied all these things with respect to temperature. But temperature is also acting as a source of energy, as well as electric field also is a source of energy. So at a very very high electric field, the atom points or the lattice points as well as impurity centers, they start vibrating a lot. And the ionic interaction between two lattice impurities, that increases. And all because of that, the electron and holes, they are much deviated from their projected path. So they were projecting to somewhere, but all because of all those abnormal interactions, they are deviated from that, and all because of that, mobility comes down. So mobility comes down at higher field, and therefore it's something like this. So what happens, what we projected or expected, that if we'll keep on increasing the electric field, the mobility will keep, the drift velocity will keep on increasing and we'll be getting more and more drift current density. But no, I'm sorry, this is not the case. If we increase electric field much beyond to a certain point, this is not very much strict, we can have a different value also, then lots of abnormal effect, they come into the picture, all because of that mobility degradation take place. And due to mobility degradation, mobility degrades, comes to a lower value, and therefore, all due to that, the VD saturates. So you see, E is increasing and mu is decreasing. So if when that happens, then there comes a saturation value, that the further electric field improvement or the further electric field energy is only absorbed by either the atoms or lattice centers or the impurity centers. So that external energy is not being given to the free carriers. So all because of that, the electric field increases, but the mobility keeps on decreasing severely, and drift velocity is up to a saturated value, and that is known as VD sat, saturation velocity. And strictly this phenomenon is happening in the drift case. So this is called saturation velocity, it comes to a saturated value. So okay, all due to that, we find that there happens lots of abnormal effects, especially in those devices where we are trying to exploit the use of drift phenomena. So at this, due to mobility degradation, mu decreases,
increases, so therefore VD is equals to mu E saturates.
But this only happens at high electric field. At low electric field, the relation is still okay, it is almost linear. So therefore we'll have to be aware, or we'll have to be very much cautious when we are applying a high electric field. So the devices in which we are making use of drift phenomena will get affected by this effect. And that main device is basically MOSFET or JFET, where we are utilizing the drift phenomena in order to have the carrier flow. Though it is too early to comment about that, but maybe all due to some previous knowledge, we all know that in bipolar junction transistor, mainly we are exploiting the use of diffusion phenomena in order to get the current out of that device. And in MOSFETs or in JFETs, in fact, we are basically utilizing or exploiting the drift phenomena in order to come up with the current. So there in MOSFETs, we'll definitely encounter with this effect. If at a fixed range or fixed distance of channel, we keep on increasing the electric field or the potential difference. So okay, this is one abnormal effect which we should take care of.
So having studied the mobility degradation and the velocity saturation, it is the time to quickly understand the temperature coefficient of resistivity. So here we are interested in to identify whether the resistance of a semiconductor increases or decreases with the temperature, as well as we'll try to compare it with the case of conductors. Okay, so what happens in semiconductors? You see, we have already seen as temperature increases, one phenomena of what is happening is, as temperature increases, we have seen that mobility degrades well beyond room temperature. It degrades, all because I'll again clarify it, more and more lattice or phonon vibrations. So therefore a particle or a free electron or hole will find it difficult to move around if the atoms are vibrating at their places. So the ultimate result was the mu is limited by mu L, lattice scattering phenomena. So therefore mu decreases. So this is one effect. On the other side, as ET, which is KT, increases, all because of that there are more number of covalent bond breakage, and the intrinsic carrier concentration or the internal contribution of carrier concentration increases, because more and more intrinsic covalent bonds are breaking, so more and more free holes and electrons are being generated. So this tells us that N, P increase, and delta N is equals to delta P, because this generation is all due to the temperature increase, so all the increment in number of carriers will always be in pair. Okay, so with that it increases. So therefore, if we see on the other side, we have seen as mu decreases, but if we increase electric field, then there comes an effect that VD saturates. So one should not merge this effect with this velocity saturation. So therefore I am writing it here. So there we understood what happens if we increase the electric field. Here we are defining what happens if we absolutely, or if we are only increasing the temperature. So we just are interested into this phenomena. So what happens? The conductivity is NQ mu. And this is not only for electrons, similarly we can write for holes, but that is not required. We can understand it analytically from here itself. So it says that mu decreases, but N increases. So the increment in the free carrier concentration is much more dominating effect than mobility decrement. So
let me quantify this. The carrier concentration increment is more dominating than mobility degradation. So ultimately what will happen, that this sigma will increase. You see, an increment in N is more dominant than the decrement in mobility, that effect. So ultimately conductivity increases. So as temperature increases, conductivity increases, which indicates the positive temperature coefficient of conductivity. But generally in electrical science, we are more interested in temperature coefficient of resistivity. So we can see if conductivity increases, obviously resistivity decreases, because you know resistivity is 1 upon sigma, so definitely it decreases. So negative temperature coefficient of resistivity. So that is what happens. So if we are increasing the temperature, then for a piece of semiconductor, be it intrinsic or extrinsic, the total resistance of it will definitely and definitely decrease in some sense. Okay, then what happens to the conductors? Though we cannot model with this factor, but just for the sake of comparison, we can make benefit of this formula here itself. This is not the exact modeling for the internal phenomenon between the conductors or metal, but we can achieve some approximation. So here, see what happens as temperature increases. Then again, two things can happen. The increment in N is negligible. Why? Because already we know in conductors, in good conductors or in metals, there are lots of free carriers already available. So almost as many as possible carriers have got already free. So there is nothing much to improve. So already lots of carriers are free. So all due to the increment of temperature, there is very slight increment of further carriers. Otherwise, we have already exploited the full potential of this material. So therefore, the N increment is negligible. That's what we are saying. Okay, so the other effect is the whole energy, which is as a thermal energy, it significantly increases the lattice scattering. So all because the atoms and the the atoms, lattice atoms, they'll start vibrating. So that's what we call lattice scattering or phonon scattering. So that will happen. So any carrier which is passing through will have a fair or better probability of having a collision or having interacted with the atom. So more atomic interactions with the carriers. So it will produce a hindrance or influence on the carrier's motion. So therefore the mobility effectively comes down. So if mobility comes down, then we can expect very easily that N Q mu, this whole thing comes down. So this says there is a negative temperature coefficient for conductivity, or 1 upon rho, or I must say 1 upon sigma, which is rho, increases. So as temperature increases, the resistivity or resistance increases. So therefore indicates positive temperature coefficient of resistivity. In lots of public sector exam, it is directly asked. So whenever we are confused or we forget, we can always start our analysis from the theory which we have covered so far. So okay, for a single piece of semiconductor, if we increase the temperature, the effective resistance, total resistance, will definitely come down. But here, for the same piece of metal or a good conductor, if we start with, and now if we increase the temperature, then the total resistance of that material increases. So that's how it is. Now the last point is, having given a piece of semiconductor, if we do not have any idea what type of semiconductor is it, is it intrinsic, extrinsic, or if it is extrinsic, then what is the nature, whether it is n-type, p-type, then how would we determine that it is n-type or p-type? Because anyhow we cannot see inside at microscopic level and identify that okay, the dominant carriers are electrons or the dominant carriers are holes, that we cannot see. So if it is a black box, it is given to us, then how to determine whether a given piece of semiconductor is n-type or p-type? And once it is known, then how to determine the carrier concentration? So this is a very important experiment here to identify all these things, and it is known as Hall effect or Hall's experiment. Suppose we start with the n-type piece of semiconductor. Then the question would be, if you already know it is n-type, then why will be performing Hall's effect? But suppose this is not known to us, but somehow it is actually the n-type, but at the end we'll confirm it to be n-type. So somehow if it is n-type, then the majority carrier concentration is of electrons. So if we look at inside microscopic level, we'll find that all free carriers are effectively electrons, because there is a 10 to the power 5, 10 to the power 6, or 10 to the power 7 order difference between the concentration of electrons than to free holes. So we can assume that holes are negligible. So almost all the free candidates or free carriers are only electrons into this. So okay, with this picture, if let's say we impart a current into this direction, if this is the direction of current, which I call J, or I, in the Y direction. So from the external setup, we can place it into a loop where we are forcing a current to move from this end to this end, from left to right end. So if in the positive Y direction. So that current source we have applied. And let's say we also do one more thing, we apply a magnetic field also. So first of all, if there is a current in this direction, so the electrons are actually moving in the opposite direction. So any electron inside is actually moving in this direction. Then only, means all of the electrons are moving in this direction, I am not showing that complicated figure. So if any electron or all the electrons are moving in the direction, so the current is like this. So but in this case, the scenario is just reverse. We have already pushed a current into it. So therefore, it makes electrons to, all the electrons to move to this side, from right to left. So because this, from the external setup, we are forcing this current inside. Okay. So the electron is moving to this side. And if I apply a magnetic field also to, let's say, in this direction, B X or H X, so like this we have applied the magnetic field. So that If we do so, if we have applied a magnetic field in this direction, all due to arrangement of some permanent magnets, then what will happen? So the electron is already moving in this direction because a current is imposed. Then this electron will experience. So if I look at from here, front view will tell me that electron, this is electron, not ion, please mind it, is moving in this direction. Okay,
and maybe it has acquired some drift velocity, so that I'll be writing very soon. And then this is the magnetic field is coming out of the plane like this. So this is Bx and this is the current density. Oh, I'm sorry, this is the drift velocity of electron. So once it happens, then we know there is a force called Lorentz force, magnetic force, on a charged particle moving in a magnetic field is Q into V cross B, where V is the drift velocity, V cross B. But this is assumingly, or this is kept, or this formula convention is for positive charge. So let us identify for positive charge, all because electron is negatively charged, so the direction would be opposite. Okay, so V cross B velocity in this direction and B is in the front direction. So V cross B, from the right hand thumb rule, if we place all our four fingers into the direction of velocity, so this is the drift velocity, and because magnetic field is coming out of the plane like this, so V cross B, so this gives thumbs up. So the force should be in the upward direction for positive charge, but all because this is electron, so there will be a force onto it into the just opposite direction. So V cross B gives the direction of force upwards for positive charge. So for electron moving this side, there will be a force downwards. So ultimately there will be a force downwards on electron. So this will be into minus Z direction. So what will happen? There will happen a phenomena that all the electrons which are moving to this direction, they will also experience a force downwards. So all the electrons will try to settle downwards. So all the majority carriers, all the main carriers are electrons only, because this is n-type we already know and we are going to confirm it. So all the electrons will try to come downwards and they will accumulate at the bottom plate. So all the electrons will accumulate at this bottom plate. So if this happens, then the scenario will be, okay, let me show the box here. So all the electrons have gathered here at the bottom plate because the force is downwards. So all because of that, there will appear a polarity. This will get positively polarized and this side will get negatively polarized. So it means there will be a potential difference appear like this, plus minus VH, and this voltage which appears all due to this polarization is called Hall's voltage. And how to check it out? Then what will happen, because more and more electrons will be doing like this, so there will be a Hall's voltage like plus minus. So there will be an electric field from positive to negative side. So this electric field would try to become like this. Okay, so this will be the direction all due to the polarity, and according to this direction, this is the direction of electric field. So this electric field will make a force QE onto a positive charge in the downward direction. So onto electron, this will make an upward direction force. So ultimately the resultant will be a scenario. So all due to Hall's voltage, let me write the development. There will be electric field, and force of that electric field will be Q into E. Now that E is actually in this direction. So for electron, this will be in opposite direction, because this electric force is for positive charge. So for electron, the force will be in the opposite direction. So this will be in plus Z direction. So what will happen? In steady state, this minus Z direction force will become equals to plus Z direction force, and everything will be in equilibrium. So at
steady state. Thus, FB magnitude will become FE magnitude. So, therefore, V cross B, I'm not writing because this was just to identify that there is a minus z direction movement for electrons, and opposite thing will also happen due to electric force. So Q V D B, because I have written the magnitude, is equals to Q into E electric field or Hall's electric field, E into EH. So this EH, which corresponds to the Hall's voltage VH, is basically Hall's electric field. And all due to that, we can cancelize it and we can determine EH is VD into B. Now you see, all because we do not know VD directly, all because we do not know EH, or we cannot identify or observe electric field, better we can identify the voltage. So EH is some voltage in between these two plates, these two extremes. So therefore, if the thickness of this is, let's say, T, okay, so if the thickness of this piece of semiconductor is T, then this EH is VH by T. So voltage difference divided by distance is nothing but electric field. So we can replace this EH as VH by T, thickness is equals to B into VD. Now you see drift velocity. Drift velocity we very well know because we have applied J current density here, or we have applied a current from outside I. So current from outside I is into this cross section, into this. So if this cross sectional area, this one, is cross section area, let's say is A, cross section area, then the current I total will be J into A. And J we can write as sigma E or NQ mu E into A, out of which this is conductivity, or if we see mu into E, this is drift velocity. So mu into E is drift velocity, we all know this. So this I can write as NQVD, drift velocity into A. So VD basically is I upon NQA. So therefore I can write here, I had to write drift velocity. So drift velocity is I upon NQA. Why we are doing this actually is all because in the experimental setup, what we know is the magnetic field which we have applied, that all we know. We only know the current, we even do not know the current density. It is difficult to identify current density for an uneven piece of semiconductor. We know the total current. So everything we want to get into the terms of experimental setup parameters. So, okay, now we have got it. So from here, the VH Hall's voltages. Okay, so it is this. Now what about area? We have seen this cross-sectional area is A. So A is, if this width is, let's say, W, thickness is T, width is W, so cross-sectional area is nothing but W into T. So this cross-sectional area is nothing but W into T, so T and T gets cancelled, and therefore it becomes B into I upon NQW. This is the final form of Hall's voltage. So the Hall's voltage is VH is B into I NQ into W voltage. Okay, so now what will happen? So now we'll look from the front view. So front view says that this was the piece of semiconductor, and what all we want to understand for its dimension is only this width, so that is required here. So if this
width which is going inside is required, then we have applied B, so it is known. Applied I, it is known. Dimensions, specifically W, is known. That all we are applying, we are setting up an experiment, so we all know that. So therefore, now what we can do, there will develop a plus minus VH voltage. So if we apply a voltmeter across this terminal, we can calculate VH. Then VH is experimentally observed or identified. So that we calculate experimentally, that's what is the aim, Hall's voltage. So once it is known, then we can calculate NQ is equals to BI by W into VH. N into Q, which is called the charge concentration, that can be known, or sometimes also known as Hall's coefficient. So that I'm not writing, that's not very important, but sometimes it is also called Hall's coefficient. So that is BI upon WVH, if that is known, because everything onto the right hand side is known or experimentally observed, then we can calculate N. It is BI by QWVH. So carrier concentration can be calculated. Okay, so here we are knowing two things. First of all, we'll see if the direction of polarity is like this, then it confirms it is N-type. Why? Because if you see, had it been a P-type material, suppose we had a P-type material, I will show everything same setup. Let's say this is a P-type material actually, then there are lots of holes. Then with the same setup, because we do not know internally what is happening, so in the same setup we are applying to this side, we are applying I, and there is a magnetic field like this coming out of the plane. The same setup as we provided for this piece of semiconductor, we are still providing, because it is a black box. We do not know in the start that whether it is N-type or P-type. If we do so, then what happens that for a hole actually is moving in this direction, because if that is the external or the pushed current into it, so that will push holes to move to this side, because holes are positively charged. Okay, so all due to that, if we still apply this formula VD cross B, then what will happen, there will be FB which will be in VD cross B. So for holes also there will be a downward direction. Why it becomes downward? Because VD changes, also the polarity of Q changes here. So the drift velocity is this side, earlier it was in this direction, and then the convention, sign convention for Lorentz force or for magnetic force also changes. So therefore there will be a force is still in the minus Z direction. Okay, so there will be getting FB like this. All due to that, lots of holes will try to accumulate here. All the holes will try to accumulate here. So every time the scenario is same. All the electrons were trying to accumulate at the bottom plate. Again, the holes are trying to accumulate at the bottom plate. But this time, because the holes have been accumulated to the bottom plate, bottom plate will get polarized as a positive terminal. And this one become relatively as a negative terminal. So this Hall's voltage this time is in this fashion. Earlier it was like this. So by just observing the polarity of the Hall's voltage, we can identify if it is like this, then the material inside is N-type semiconductor. If it is this, then we'll come to know. So we'll apply a voltmeter and then we'll identify whether it is showing the negative voltage or positive voltage. If the bottom plate terminal is the positive voltage as per the voltmeter connection, then this positive voltage is the confirming the P-type nature of the semiconductor. But if it comes negative, that confirms the N-type nature of the. So the polarity of Hall's voltage decides the type of material. Okay, And again, the process, this thing is independent of whether it is n-type or p-type, so everything will remain same. Just the difference will be here, we will come to know the holes concentration. So, P will be B into I upon Q W V H. So, if it is extrinsic semiconductor, we will come to know the holes concentration per or number of holes per unit volume, so that we can very easily get similar to this. So therefore, as a result, what we can conclude is applications of Hall's effect. The first and foremost important application is to identify the type of semiconductor. If it is n-type or p-type, but what will happen if it is intrinsic? See, in the intrinsic case, because if we force current this side, what we are doing in the experimental setup, then electrons and holes both will come down. So with the equal amount of electron and holes, there won't be any polarity developed. So this is not for, so if you are not getting any significant voltage, this will confirm that the material is intrinsic. So identify type of the semiconductor, it identifies whether it is intrinsic or extrinsic, then it also identifies that whether it is n-type or p-type by observing the Hall's voltage polarity. So by observing the Hall's voltage polarity, we can very quickly come to know, actually it is meant for identifying whether it is n-type or p-type. We never are interested in the case of intrinsic, but ultimately we can also utilize it to distinguish between these two. Okay. Then once we can only identify the difference or the clarification between intrinsic and extrinsic. If it is intrinsic, we cannot calculate all these things because there is no voltage developed or there is no electric field, so we cannot proceed further. So therefore, we cannot identify the intrinsic carrier concentration. Unfortunately, that cannot be determined. But if it is extrinsic, which is the more important, more practical case, then we can calculate the carrier concentration. So, carrier or charge concentration can be calculated. Okay. So we can identify N or P, or means once at a time, either the material will be P type or N type. Okay, and what else? You see, if other elements are known, then we can identify this B from here. So if N is known already, then B could be given as Q W V H into N by I. So sometimes it is also used as if we have a piece of semiconductor where the carrier concentration is already known, so then we can utilize to calculate or to observe or to measure the magnetic field. So can we use as magnetometer so that also we can do. If the right hand side is known to us, we can calculate the magnetic field. So in a region when there is a magnetic field and we are not able to measure it, we can measure it using the Hall's experiment. So that also we most of the time do. So this is the effect of Hall's voltage, and most of the numericals are only asked from this. So anytime if we are confused or if we forget something, we can always start from this very well known figure. So it will take just half a minute to come to this conclusion anytime. So this we can come, or otherwise we should try to remember this NQ or this Hall's voltage, this Hall's voltage, we should better remember this formula. So anytime we can calculate anything if remaining things are given to us. Okay, so with this we have finalized almost all the topics, all the important understandings into the
first module, semiconductor theory. So we are still left with one more lecture, lecture number 6. The very next lecture would be totally dependent on or totally based on the problems and solutions, and mainly those tricky problems and solutions which are appeared. So before that, just a quick review problem for the conductivity or for the this section of carrier conduction of this extrinsic semiconductor. Now it is just a simple review problem. It states that the sample of silicon at room temperature has a resistivity this. Okay, the sample is not doped. So earlier it was intrinsic, now it is being doped with the extent of this much donor atom. So this is nothing but ND, which is being provided to us. Okay, and this much acceptor atoms. Okay, so this is Na. Okay, find the current density. Okay, if an electric field this. So we are supposed to calculate the final electron and hole concentration, and once they are known, we can find the total current density. And there is no scenario of carrier concentration gradient, so we will not thought of diffusion current density. So whatever current density has been demanded is only drift current density. So by the problem statement, it can be identified there is no scene of concentration gradient. So, and only electric field is given to us, so there cannot be a diffusion current, there can only be a drift current density. So J total, or this is drift, will be J drift all due to N and J drift all due to P. That we can write sigma N E conductivity into electric field plus sigma P into E. Now this anytime we can write sigma N E plus sigma P E, or I can write sigma N is nothing but N Q mu N plus P Q mu P E E into both. Now if I take common Q into E, so this is N mu N plus P mu P Q into E. So we have to get this. This is known to us, this is known to us. Electric field is given. Okay, mu n and mu p are also given, and mu n and mu p are though mu n is generally 2 or 2.5 times greater than mu p, but still there is not lots of difference in the order. So the only thing depends on n and p. We'll see if the p is much less than n, then we can neglect this term, because that is expected. As we can see, nd is approximately the final electron concentration is 4 into 10 to the power 14 centimeter square per centimeter, I'm sorry, and P or the Na is this. So ND is much greater than Na, because it is two orders more than this Na. So therefore, if it is the case, then we can start from identifying N as ND minus Na by 2, the root ND minus Na by 2 whole square plus Ni square. Okay, for that we need to know Ni. Also, this Na is neglected, this Na is neglected, all because ND is greater than Na. So this only remains us with ND by 2 plus ND by 2 square plus Ni square. Okay, now we can also say that ND is greater than Ni by our experience, but from the problem statement we should not identify it exactly. If there is a mean to identify Ni, let us find Ni, and then quantitatively we will argue that ND is greater than Ni. So in the starting we cannot comment this. So you see the resistivity of intrinsic, so the sample of silicon is doped later on, so earlier it was intrinsic. So the resistivity is this, that means conductivity, intrinsic conductivity, which is NQ mu N plus NIQ mu P, because Ni is the concentration of holes, Ni is the concentration of electrons, so that is being given as resistivity, so it is inverse of that. Okay, So we can very soon calculate it. So 10 to the power minus 2, 4 into 10 to the power minus 2 Siemens per centimeter. Okay. So this has been provided to us. From there we can identify Ni. So Ni will be taken as common. So this value 4 into 10 to the power minus 2 will be divided by Q into mu n plus mu p. So now let us check analytically. Q is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 into something which is of the order of 10 to the power 3 maximum. So I'm not exactly writing it, I'm just looking at in what range it comes. So once it goes up, it becomes 10 to the power minus 16, it goes up 14 or something very bad it gives me. So it is approximately 10 to the power 10. You can calculate it. Okay, so this comes around this. So if it is 10 to the power 10, we argue that ND is also greater than NI. So therefore, N is approximately ND. And P therefore will be approximately Ni square by Nd. So that will be much less than this. So ultimately result will be N is greater than P. So therefore we need not to carry. I'm saying we need not to carry it. Even if you carry it, it will hardly make any difference after two or three places of decimals. So therefore we do not require it. It is approximately N mu n q into E. So therefore N is this, is Nd, and Nd is 4 into 10 to the power 14 into mu n. Mu n is 1350 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 into electric field is also in volts per centimeter, 4 volts per centimeter. So this gives me the current density as this much ampere per centimeter square. So this is coming as, okay, so the value comes as 0.3456 ampere per centimeter square. You see how much improvement do we get. Earlier when we calculated it in, let's say, lecture number 2 or 3, I guess, when we were studying intrinsic semiconductor current density, then we calculated that we were getting some 10 to the power minus 3 or minus 4 ampere per centimeter square, or even much less than that. So now the current density has been improved by 4 or 5 order. So therefore this is a much improved results, and this doping and this is all due to the doping concentration. So the result or the conclusion is where we started from, that the extrinsic semiconductors finally they gave us the good range of commercial currents or good current densities which could be utilized in the commercial applications or in commercial electronics.